Our guest, first of all, there's only one microphone on the stage, as you can see. So instead of being interviewed, as sometimes happens, our guest is going to be all by himself. And he hails from the entertainment world of Southern California. He is a producer, engineer, songwriter, guitarist, keyboardist, drum programmer, and A&R executive. 25 plus years of experience in the business. He has worked on records that combined have sold over 15 million copies with artists including Oriente, Jessica Sanchez, Fergie, Gwen Stefani, and above all, the pop diva Christina Aguilera. And he has also been an A&R person for Sony Music and Epic Records. And he is currently A&R for Faircraft Records in Los Angeles. Please welcome to Loyola, Ron Harris.
All right, how's it going? All right, first of all, we got to get rid of this mic stand, right? You know, we don't need that. So we're going to have an amazing conversation today. And I got to tell you, I'm really, really excited to be here. And my buddy Ethan here, you know, I just got to give it up for you for doing that, man. Boom. So here's the thing, guys. I mean, I can speak from the musician standpoint all the way over to the management standpoint, to the record industry standpoint for those of you who want to be behind the scenes. So we're going to do, once we get to a certain point, we'll do question and answers. And please don't hesitate. Whatever question you want to ask, just bring it. We'll talk about it. And that's one of the best ways to learn. So I wasn't always, well, I guess we could say successful in the music business. So I'm going to tell you how that all started, just to give you an idea of where I get my talents and my thoughts and everything from. Got it? Is that cool? Cool? All right. If I'm boring you along the way, it's a forum, right? Okay, so check it out. So I'm a kid from the projects of Chicago, right? So, you know, I would have never thought that I would end up here in this moment because it wasn't part of the dream, right? You know, you just start playing in a band and, you know, I was a drummer actually in a band. But when I was younger, my mom was a gospel musician, but she would like have these parties, right? And she would play music and I wanted to know the songs she was playing. So I couldn't hear them in my bedroom. So I would take my ear and put it up against the wall and try and identify the song that was playing. So it was a game that I started to create with myself probably when I was like 8 or 9, not realizing that my ears became the thing that would help me be successful in my career. So you never know where it's going to start at. But that's where I started. Then I started playing drums, and I got in a band, you know, like everybody else, right, you know. I wanted to be Prince. Yes, this is true. My hair used to be this long, you know. I had a carefree curl, not a Jerry curl. There's a distinct difference. The Jerry curl had the dripping gel. Mine was kind of, you know, just layered a little bit. That's all I'm saying about that, right? So at any rate, I got into home recording like back in 1983. That's when it started becoming affordable. So, you know, I had my little money. I bought my little 4-track. I thought I was doing something, you know. And we didn't have drum machines back then. We used to take, there was a record that we had, and you all know what records are, right? I know you do. I'm just kidding, right? So we used to take this drum drops record, and it would have beats on it. And we would play this on 1 track, and then I'd get my buddies to come over and put bass on another track, guitar on another track, and we would bounce those 3 tracks down to 1 track and then do it all over again. You couldn't tell us that it wasn't happening, right? It was sounding great. It was fantastic. So that's when my production chops just started, you know, just I started defining it a little bit more because, you know, I had this crappy sounding cassette, but you couldn't tell me it didn't sound like $1 million, right? That's, you know. So I started doing the very first session I had was a young lady who paid me to redo a song by an artist named Denise Williams. And I recorded her vocal on it, and people liked what I did. And she paid me like $300. I was like, what? And I'm like, oh my God, you made that vocal sound so good. I was like, what? Really? And that's what like kicked it off. So I started getting more into home recording. And eventually, you know, I used to just spend all of my money on gear. And now my first, you know, break came. And this is how my first break came. I'm working a job, a regular job. I was working at an HMO in Chicago. And I would go home for lunch. So I went home at lunchtime this one particular day to work on music, you know. And a guy named Marlon Jackson, who was Michael Jackson's brother, was promoting a solo record. So he was on the radio station in Chicago, and they were taking callers. And I'm like, maybe I'll call in and see if he's looking for songs, right? So I call in, and I said, hey, I just want to talk to Marlon and see if he's looking for songs. And the guy asked him, said, hey, are you looking for songs? And he's like, yeah, you know. And he goes, well, they got to be hot. And I'm like, all right. So Marlon gets on the phone, and he goes, hey, how you doing? And I'm like, damn, he sounds just like Mike, you know what I mean? And he's like, oh my God, right? And at this point, you know, you have to understand, in Chicago, you don't get to talk to artists or anything. So trust me, I'm freaking out, but I'm at home by myself going, you know, and I'm just so cool with it, right? Yeah, you know, I just want to know, are you looking for songs, right? And he's like, well, yes, I am, because I'm going to be doing my next album. I'm like, okay. I'm like, do you want to hear it? And he goes, yeah. So I take the phone, because I'm working on my tracks, and I put it up to the speaker. Just like, hold on a second. You don't know if it's distorted or what, right? Because you got it turned, I got it cranked, right? And I'm just like, man, this is it right now. And so I get back on the phone, and he goes, yeah, Ron, that sounds pretty hot. Why don't you just send it to me? You know, I'm like, okay, great. He goes, here's my number. Just call me. I don't know why I keep doing his voice like that, but it kind of, it works great for the effect, right? You know, so I'm like, all right. So I hang up the phone. I go back to work. Hey, y'all, guess what? I just talked to Marlon Jackson, right? And they're like, so you're telling me you went home, called him up in the radio station, and he answered the phone and gave you his phone number. Yeah, yeah, exactly, just like that. Yeah, okay, all right, great. So nevertheless, so I sent him a tape, right? You know, and the tape was only just an instrumental at the time. So this was in about, I want to say, May, and I never heard from him. And I kept calling, and then his housekeeper kept answering the phone. But at that time, I didn't know about a promotional tour. So he was promoting his album, so I didn't understand what a promotional tour was. So about 5 months had passed, and I was going to call a friend of mine. I take my phone book, and I throw it across the bed, right? And it just opened to Marlon's phone number. And I'm like, you know what? I'm going to call him right now, right? So I call him up, and he answers the phone. And I said, hey, Marlon? And he goes, yeah. I said, you know, this is Ron from Chicago. I don't know if you remember me, but I, you know, talked to you when you were at the radio station. And he goes, yeah, I remembered you. You know, I never got your tape. And he goes, I'm recording my album right now, so I need some songs. I said, okay, well, I'll send you some out, right? So this was on a Thursday. I had zero songs. I had none, but I had 100 pieces of an idea. You know, I mean, I'm sure for those of you who are here songwriters, right, you know, it's like I just never got around to finishing it, right? You know how we always are in that constant work in progress. Yeah, you know, I'm going to finish it, and then I'm going to add this, right? So now I'm freaking out. So I'm like, Marlon wants a song. So I go in the room and I start working on a song. And it just didn't come to me. But there was a piece that I had of this one song that I called my buddy up. And I said, man, we need to finish this song because Marlon Jackson is looking for songs. And he's like, okay. We finish it on a weekend. I send it to him on a Monday. He calls me at work on a Tuesday, right? And, of course, the secretary didn't believe that it was one of the Jacksons. She's like, Ron, there's a Marlon Jackson on the phone for you? I go, yeah, oh my God, right? So this is on a Tuesday. So I get on the phone, and he's like, hey, Ron, how you doing? This is Marlon. I was like, dude, I know who you are. Nobody talks like that. You know what I mean? That high. I was like, you're the only guy I know, you know. And but I was cool. He goes, hey, I really like your song. And then he started quizzing me in a way that I was kind of like, huh? He goes, so who produced it? I said, well, I did. And he goes, well, who did the drums? I go, well, I'm like, this is silly. I'm like, I did, because I didn't realize that in L.A. people hire people to do all of this stuff, right? And I go, dude, I recorded it at home. This was when we had a drum machine that had come out, because I'm a gear junkie, right? So it was the first MPC 60, and I was trailblazing with it. It was like, you know, and so he goes, dude, I really love this song. And I'm like, great. I could have hung up the phone right then and been great. Then he goes, I want you to produce it on my record. What? What? He goes, yeah, you know, so I'll pay you like $5,000. And I'm like, get out, right? Because I would have done it for free. So this was on a Tuesday. So then he goes, can you come out here Friday? This Friday? He's like, yeah. He goes, so I'm going to call. I'm going to get you to the airport and have your friend, you know, whoever cut the vocals. So I want you to come out here Friday, and I know you got to go to work Monday. So why don't you come out Friday, Saturday, Sunday? We'll cut the record, and then you can go back to work on Monday. I'm like, this is great, right? So I call up my buddy. Dude, Marlon's going to fly us out there. He's like, get out, right? I'm like, no, right? We get to the airport, our tickets are there. He flies us to LA. He comes, that's when you could walk in the airport, right? Back then. He comes and meets us at the gate. You know, we're like little kids, like, oh, dude. Yo, what's up, man? Hey, yeah. You know, hey, yeah. Yeah, it's cool. Yeah, what's up, man? You know, we could do the record, right? So we go to his house in Encino, right? I cut the record, do everything. He was working with, this is when MC Hammer was hot. And he played. But Capitol wanted him to work with MC Hammer, and they played his record, and I was like, damn, that sounds great. I mean, it was like turned up to 20. I was like, and the Jacksons, they listen loud. I mean, it's like club in a little bitty closet space, right? I'm like, yeah, man, that's hot, right? It's like so loud. And after that, we became great friends, and I ended up doing 5 records with them. Right? Now, that was my start. That was my first professional start. Downside, records never came out. So I was crushed. Just like, oh, you know, because you didn't have the internet. So all my friends in Chicago were like, okay, so let me get this straight. Marlon, of all the people he can choose to do songs, chose songs from you. I'm like, yeah. And he's been flying you out there. And you don't have any copy to play because they're not giving you copies. I'm like, yeah. And so the record's not coming out now. I'm like, I mean, I was just like crushed, man. Like, God. But what it taught me was how to be prepared, right? So that was that thing, right? So from that point, I never lost track of having songs ready. And then as life went on, I hooked up with Marlon's A&R guy. And everyone here knows what an A&R person is, right? Yep, everybody, good. So this is a music program. You better know, right? That makes sense. So I went and paid $300 and went to a seminar where Marlon's A&R person was talking. Waited, talked to him, and I'm just like, hey, how's it going? How you doing? My name is Ron. And he goes, hey, man, how you doing? What's up? I said, you know, I did some songs with Marlon Jackson. And then he goes, well, which ones did you do? I said, well, I did I Like to Know You Better, Love Versus Love, Lovers Come, Lovers Go. His eyes are just growing massive. And he's like, dude, I need to talk to you. And I'm like, oh, this is it. This is, you know what I mean? This is it. So I called him in the hotel the next morning. Now, at this point in my career, I was getting into producing and writing, but I was also a drummer, right? And so I was a drummer for hire. So I was doing the circuit in Chicago, you know, like stick bag, drum set, you know, this is the real music. I was like off in the jazz fusion and, you know. And so Scott Folks, I called him and he said to me, what do you want to do? And I just threw up all of my ideas on him. Oh, man, I want to be in a band. I want to be an artist. You know, I want to have my own record label. I want to da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. And then he says to me, he goes, Ron, sounds to me like you don't know what you want to do. I was like, yeah, I do. I just told you everything I want to do. And he goes, listen, man, I'm going to tell you, in this business or anything, you got to be focused. And he says, I'm not saying that you can't do all of those things, but you'll be a jack of all trades and a master of none, right? And that hit me like a ton of bricks. So I sat back, and that night I thought about, where did I want my career to take me? Hence is why I'm telling you this story about getting laser focused, right? So I said, you know what? I want to get paid at least $5,000 for a song, as opposed to $50 for a drum gig, because that's the way it was back then. Hey, man, can you do this gig for me for $50, right? And then I was like, I want record execs to call me. I don't know if I want to be called to play any more Earth, Wind, and Fire songs, right? It's just the way it is. So that next day, I put my drums in the paper, and I sold them, and I told my friends, never call me for any more gigs. And they're like, what, dude, what? I was like, no, man, that's it for me, right? So that's when, that was the first moment that I pivoted into being a producer. And, you know, I made cards up, and I had to practice saying it. So my whole career, I used to say, yeah, I'm a drummer. And then I was like, okay, I'm a record producer. I couldn't even say, hey, Ron Harris, record producer. I was practicing, right? I was like, God, that feels so weird. But, you know, I'm a firm believer in you've got to really, really believe it, and you got to own it in order so other people can believe in you, right? And I made that transition, and then I just started producing and doing things, and I was still working, but then I quit my job because I felt that I had one foot in the music business and one foot out. And I felt like God wasn't giving me two shoes. He kept throwing one shoe at me. And I was like, man, what about the other shoe? You know? So that's what got me into it. And then I got the job doing A&R. And that was a great experience. And so, you know, I'm going to talk to you guys about doing A&R and finding talent, right? I had Usher when he was 14. I tried to take him to Epic Records. And they were like, he's too young. I'm like, yo, but he's dope, right? You know, because I was in Atlanta, and I was like, and it's like, no, we just think he's too young. I'm like, oh, my God. I had another group that I tried to sign at Columbia named Marilyn Manson, right? And you would think, well, how did you go from Usher to Marilyn Manson, right? And I'm going to tell you how. Now, when I got hired, a guy named Tommy Mottola hired me. And the scariest thing on the planet, I ain't gonna lie, in my job interview. And I sat there in his office, and he taught me. He says, listen, man, he says, you got to go look under rocks. You got to find super talent just under rocks because they're out here. But you just got to go look where no one else is looking, right? And the other thing that I learned along the way is I don't have to love it. But if I'm going to see an act and they've got the place packed every night, that means that there's a movement going on. Something is going on, right? And that's what happened with Marilyn Manson. And he was brilliant. I mean, just brilliant. And we did a showcase in New York, and I'm thinking I'm doing something by inviting the head of Columbia down. He stayed 5 minutes, turned to me, and I ain't gonna say all the words that he said, but the summation was, this is the worst beep, 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 you know, thing that I've seen. And I'm like, but, right? So I'm like, wow, this is crazy. You know, I'm thinking this is how you're supposed to do it. You should find an act that's great and, you know, take it to the label. But, you know, there are politics involved, and people have to be into whatever it is in order for them to sign it, right? So here's the thing. I've got the producer side under me now. Now I'm moving into the executive side, and it's a lot different than what I thought it was. I thought it was, let me find the most talented act, take them to the record label, and they would sign them. Boy, that ain't it, right? So you've got to find what doesn't exist. For those of you who say, you know, if you want to do A&R or be on that thing or manager, they can be talented in other ways. They don't have to be the best singer. They don't have to be the best band, but they've got to be special. They've got to wear it on their sleeve. Now, when you guys talk, I don't know how your classes work. Do you guys talk specifically about A&R and the roles of A&R? Just a little bit? And everybody knows it stands for artists and repertoire. So they're responsible for finding the artist, and they're also responsible for finding the songs for the artist, right? But there's another step. That's finding an artist, right? Finding an artist is because everybody can sing. Not everybody can sing well, but everybody can sing. And what you tend to look for, based on what your label is have they found their lane, right? So when I go to see talent, there's a couple things that come up. First of all, I'm looking to see if they know who they are. You know, do they have the thing, right? Do they believe who they are? Because that's so important. So let's look at some examples of people who know their lane. Let's take Kesha for example. She's not the best singer, but guess what? She knows, hey, we're young, let's go party, let's have fun. That is her lane, period. It doesn't even waver. Lady Gaga's lane, no one wanted to sign her when she was just a normal artist. No one. So when she started dressing all weird and doing all of these things, her lane is, well, if you like me when I'm strange, then I'm really going to push the boundaries, right? And it worked for her. Rihanna doesn't necessarily have a lane, but Rihanna chooses amazing songs. I mean, amazing songs. Adele, love songs, heartache, heartbreak. If you're going out to the club and somebody plays an Adele song, you're going to be, wait. You know, I don't want to hear that, right? Not saying that you guys are going out to the clubs or anything like that, but that's just what it is. So, at any rate, when you think about discovering talent, you've got to make sure that they're believable. Like, so those of you who want to be a manager, for those of you who want to be an A&R person, you've got to love it with everything you have because your job would be on the line, your salary, your reputation. You got to love it. I mean, just like saying, you know what? I believe that they're the next thing because you got to be willing to bet everything on it, you know? So you got to look at that and weigh it out with other things. And one of the little tricks, and I'll tell artists this, is look at Billboard magazine, right? And look at who's doing what you do and see where you fit. One of the first questions you're asked if you go into a major record label, I'm going to tell you the main question that they will ask you. And it's not going to be what you think, but they're going to go, if there was one person, one artist out there that you could eliminate and take their place, old or new, doesn't matter. Don't look at the success, but who it would, you know, if you could just, they would be gone and you would be them. Who would that be? And you got to be able to answer that question. Because what that does to a record exec is let us know where you think you are. Right? So you artists get that? You got it? Yeah. I don't know why I think this is the artist side, but it may not be. But I'm just saying that's a really, really important thing to understand. So you've got to be able to answer those questions from that standpoint of being an artist. Do you really, really want it? You know, for those of you who want to be producers, like how many in the room want to be producers? Okay. I mean, put the hands up higher. Okay. Great. Producer secrets. Get gear.
get great at your gear. Get great at Pro Tools, Logic, whatever it is to help you do what you need to do. Know it inside and out. And don't be afraid to push the boundaries. Find something to produce and push it to the edge. Because it's easy to come back, right? You know, and it's a lot of safe out there, but you got to find out how to push it to the edge to, you know, really, really get something special from that group. How many people here want to be managers? Okay, great. Be on the scene, understand what exists out there, find some groups that, you know, you can grow with, that they'll learn how to trust you and build up your connections as you go along the way. I know I'm going to open it up for questions in a couple minutes, though, because I'm just glancing over, so I want to know what's out here. What about artists? Wow. It's a lot of... Man, we got to come back here and do, like, a critique session, you know. And critiques are great, right? And the reason why critiques are great... and given the right way, is that it will help you to grow. And it is a great way to grow, because I know what it's like to be on that side of it, but I think it's important for artists to get critiques from people that are in the business so that they can take that information, put it in a blender, and see what they can create from that. Okay? All right, so let's answer some questions here. So I know we don't have a microphone, but let's hit it. Yes, sir. Oh. The question was favorite vocal chain, right? And what that is from the producer or engineer standpoint is that when we have a vocalist, what do we run them through in order to make their vocal sound great? Okay. Now, with that being said, I'm a Universal Audio guy, right? So for those who know, I have an endorsement with UA, but their stuff is amazing. There's no question. So I'll usually run it through a Neve 1073. I'll run it to an LA-2A. And then I'll just use that to let it sit, you know. And another trick I use, and I'll just tell you this, is you can do two compressors on a mix. So I'll do a slow release, slow attack, and then I'll do a fast. So I'll do a double compressor chain when I'm mixing the vocal. And then I'll split that and run that into a track that I create as an exciter. And mix to taste. Does that answer your question? Perfect, right? Yeah. Yes, sir.
So you told us earlier that you were kind of a jack of all trades, kind of had your hands in a bunch of different, you know, things. Tell us about your management background.
The management background is that came from A&R. Right? So I have a couple artists that I manage now also. The management portion, I'm not gonna lie, I did not want to do. Management, man, the managers get, especially the first managers, it's a hard job. You get no love, you get no pay, and then they want to fire you when they get success. So I had to really, really think about it before I decided if this is something that I want to do. Okay, that's cool. So with that being said, in terms of finding an artist, it's like when I say you got to find someone that you believe in. And because I have the connections already, and because I've done so much cultivating of artists, they looked at me as a manager anyway. And I was like, well, you know what? Maybe this just one. Well, maybe these two, right? Because you still have to partner up with someone down the line. You got to follow up to that, because that gentleman had one. Yes.
Real quick, so you said you prefer A&R over management any day of the week kind of thing?
No, I'm not going to say that, because if you have a successful artist, management is a lot better. you have a successful artist, and management is definitely the way to go.
Before the rise of social media and like different platforms like that, how were you able to find talented artists in different cities and stations?
Well, his question was, before social media, how were you able to find talent in different cities and in different states?
Well, like in mind, being an artist in ways that you can get yourself out there towards A&R.
Okay. So how would you find that talent? There was a mentor I had after I was hired with Tommy Mottola. His name was Bobby Colombi. And Bobby Colombi was a drummer from a band called Blood, Sweat, and Tears, right? And Bobby would teach me this out-of-the-box thinking and everything. So when I first started doing A&R, anybody who would call me with tapes, because you guys got to understand, there's a whole group of people out there who know who A&R people are, right? So what I would do is somebody would send me a tape, I'd get on a plane and go see them, right? Well, no matter where they were. And Bobby called me into his office, and he says, Ron, you're going to go crazy if you keep doing that, right? So I'm like, well, what do I do? And he goes, you got to build your army in different cities. So when I go to your city and you're the hot thing, I'm going to say, well, who's hot to you? And then I'll see that person who's hot to them, and they'll get my number. And then I'll go to another city and then another city. And that's what I used to do. So it had gotten to a point I had someone in every major city that was on the music scene. And that's how it worked. So I knew that they would call me first. See? Any other questions? Yes.
You know, you said you had your foot in the door, but at what point did you say, like, I can quit my day job and actually, like, hustle to do this and not have to go back to a day job?
Well, here's the thing. It wasn't like, oh, my gosh, I'm doing well now. I can quit my day job. It was actually, nothing's going to come to me unless I quit my day job, right? And whatever, whether it was true or not, it was true for me. And I felt like, I got to do it. I was like, this is it. And I quit my job, and I had my little money saved up, and it was the worst experience of my life. It was like crash and burn all the way. But I was committed, right? I committed myself, and I was like, because I could go back and work. Because I was young enough. I was like, well, okay, I'm not going to be homeless, right? I can work. But I really had to give my career a shot. And it was being off that I made one of those mysterious phone calls and got into A&R. That's how it worked. I want to say 28-9. Yeah. Yes, sir.
Going off of Josh's question about how you would find acts back in the day, how has that changed now with social media being so prominent?
Well, you know what? The question is, how has it changed to find talent out there right now? Well, the good thing is that social media is fantastic. And social media does help you find some things, but it doesn't help you find everything, right? Because sometimes artists get so complacent on, ooh, just let me just get this song up like this or do this, as opposed to working on their craft, right? The people in the know still do it the same old-fashioned way. It's a phone call. Hey, I got this great artist here. You need to come in and see it here. Hey, you guys put on this talent show. I get to come here. I'm going to sit here because this is under the rock, right? People call me from all over still because that army that I built out there is great. I went to this new artist I just found. I was doing a songwriters forum in Denver, Colorado in October, and she performed. I was like, oh, my God, right? So it works kind of both ways now. Then we kind of check the social media presence. It's a catch-22. It's like you don't have to have it. You do have to have it, but you don't, but you do. If that makes any sense, right? Yeah, you just can't have it, and you still got to be special, and you still got to be laser-focused. Because when I take my artists into record labels, it's good old-fashioned. You got to, if you play guitar, you got to pull out that guitar and you got to do it for real, you know, because I'm a real artist person, right? It's like you got to have some extra stuff for us to figure the rest out. Yes, sir.
What do you think are the biggest or most common pitfalls that artists fall into when they're trying to get signed?
What do I think are the biggest and most common pitfalls? When an artist is trying to get signed, that prevents them from getting signed or that messes up their career? Okay, all right. Well, let me see. It can be management. It can be parents. It can be an artist being an asshole, right? Because here's the rule of thumb. When you choose to work with an artist, you got to be involved with them. Say, give yourself as a manager. Think about this as for you manager types. Say, if I'm going to be around them for 5 years, do I like them? Right? Because that's it. You're going to be attached at the hip. And record companies, and they'll go, man, I don't know, something's wrong. And then artists can get full of themselves, right? And I'm not saying that's a bad thing, because I got to be honest with you, I only want to work with an artist that's full of themselves, right? Because that's your kind of like your guarantee that they're going to be working hard when they're not around you, right? But sometimes they can get full of themselves and think that they don't need the team to get them out there. And it's completely opposite, because record companies think the opposite. I don't care about them. Let them go. You know? So Common, I think that it would be just really have great management, great team, because you could be the talent and you can have a bad manager that can destroy the deal. Or girlfriend, boyfriend, that stuff, believe it or not, it'll kind of ruin the deal too, you know. Yes, sir, again.
So as a producer, like when you found Marilyn Manson, I'm sure he was probably really raw back then and wasn't like real. Were you able to like use that your years producer to scope what he could sound like?
No, Marilyn Manson just wasn't in my lane, right? It's not in my lane, but me and I brought in another A&R person and she's like, yo, they're great. And you just pass that on, really. That's not like, oh, let me go work with him. I mean, he's great, dude. I mean, you know, and so that wasn't like my lane in terms of let me take you in the studio and mold your sound. I just felt the moment, right, and something was going on, and it was already where it was. I mean, he knew his whole journey completely.
You just say, I can mold your sound.
We try not to, we have to help with the sound, the image, and what you are, your specialty. When you've done A&R a long time, we'll be the first one to tell you, we're not going to give you your image. You got to have that. Because if somebody tries to give it to you, it's not real. You know, so you got to have that yourself. Yes, sir.
In your personal career, how did you kind of reconcile the choice? Beyond like the financial stuff you talked about earlier, how did you kind of put one passion aside for the other and move forward?
Well, like I said, when I had my first passion was drums, because I was really into drums, right? Then once I moved into producing and songwriting, you know, are you talking about that switch or the work switch or?
When you first put on the drums.
Okay. Well, that was that conversation I had with the senior VP of Capitol Records. He was the A&R of Capitol Records, and he told me basically that I wasn't focused. I have a lot of friends that are still drumming, and trust me, I made the best decision I ever could have made in my life. And I look at that, and I don't wonder. I just go, damn, am I glad I made that choice, right? You know, so. I saw someone over here with their hand up. Anybody else? Oh, yes.
So A&R really isn't like an entry-level job. So how do you work your way to that point?
You know what? A&R, there is no, if I do this, I get to do that. It just doesn't work like that, right? It is a job. I gotta tell you, man, it's definitely not an entry level job. It is a executive job. So in the music business, the A&R people are the ones that sign the talent, develop the talent, scope the talent out. To get to be there, it's almost like you gotta know people. And the thing is they have to trust your ears. And your ears are basically, like my job interview was basically send me 10 songs that you think sound great in your area. That was my job interview. Send me 10 songs. So guess what? I call all my friends. Hey, man, I'm interviewing for Sony. Can you send me some songs? Because I knew all the songwriters in Chicago, right? You know, because I quit my job by this point. I got songs from no one. No one. So guess what I did? Sent them all 10 of my songs. Right? That's all I had. I'm up for a job interview. And I quit my job at this point. And the guy called me up, who did 2, 5, 7? I go, I did. And then he said, send me 10 more. I had one group, and they gave me 2 songs, and the other 8 were mine. And that's how I got my A&R gig. They trusted my ears, but you know what I mean? So I see people get it from knowing. Sometimes people can get it from working at a record label, working their way up. But if you find an act, that's how people trust your ears, right? So it's like you can get to someone and go, ooh, I can tell you about this act. And they go, man, you got great ears, or you got great ears, you know? But it's a hard job to get. You know, a lot of times you can start at a baby label and just take on that role and try and deal with one-offs or indies, and that can help you get there.
These speedy demos you were sending out, like, what were the quality of them?
My demos?
Yeah.
Dude, my demos sounded amazing. Yeah. I mean, and I'm not saying, oh, they were the best, but, I mean, I was an equipment junkie. I mean, I was, like, I was home recording. I had 8 tracks. I mean, I had great vocalists on it. I mean, so they sounded great. That's why he was like, well, who did this? Who did this? You know, but at this time, this was after I had worked with Marlon. So my chops were up. You know, my production chops were up. Yes, sir.
You're really dope because you're, like, you do everything.
Well.
And you're a musician.
Well, I've done everything.
Like, as a record producer.
Right.
You know, I really want to know what it was like working with people at first, like getting the most out of them.
Yeah.
And secondly, like how your role as a producer has matured.
Right. Okay. Well, here's the cool thing. Like, so working with people, how is that? Let me tell you what a producer has to do. They've got to be the therapist. They've got to be the counsel. They've got to be the judge and jury. They have to listen to a lot, right? And that definitely does evolve. The one thing that I didn't count on being, that I didn't know I was good at, was a vocal guy. I was a beat guy. I mean, I was, when Teddy Riley, I was like New Jack. I was just doing those kind of beats. And then I had a couple of singers that I had worked with, and I made the vocals sound really good. So then I got more into vocals. Now, then what I learned along the way is, when you're a producer, you have to set the mood and set the tone for the artist. I like to meet with the artist, talk to them, so I can see what's in their head, right? To make sure that I'm the right fit for that artist. You know, and I think artists should meet with producers. Don't think that your friends can do it all the time. They might not be the right ones for you. So, you know, we like to talk about to see if we have common ground. You know, somebody goes, oh my gosh, I love Prince. And I go, psh, my hair used to be long like Prince. Oh my God, you know, I love Prince too, right? And so you got to find those common things. And once you find that, once I kind of tap in into what the artist's dream is, then I'll set up my session to be like that. That artist may like flowers. That artist may like red lights. My goal is to create the best environment to get the best vocal from that artist on the planet at that precise moment. Right there. It's really low key. You don't have anybody in the studio because the vocal is a very, very delicate instrument. And like I said, I'm a vocal guy, so I'm really passionate about a vocal, and I'm extremely passionate about the first verse, because the first verse is when you introduce yourself to the world. So I want to make sure that that delivery is just like right there. So, you know, and it's just evolved, but that's where it still sits, with that basic foundation. Any other questions? Yes.
Can you talk a little bit about your experience working with some of those vocalists like Christina Aguilera and Fergie West?
Absolutely. So Fergie, let me go back. Fergie was in a group called Wild Orchid, right? And before they were signed, they used to come to my office when I did A&R. And what happened was, I was like, man, you know, and Fergie and them, they used to come in and say, hey, Ron, you know, we're going to sing the national anthem for you because we're singing it at Dodger Stadium. I was like, okay. You know, I was like, it's all right. You know what I mean? I was like, it needs a little something else on it, right? So I introduced them to a writer that I had found out of Kansas City, another Under the Rock, right? they wrote like 5 songs together. Wild Orchid got signed, whatever. You know, after that record didn't happen, then when Fergie was out on her own, Fergie is a beast, man. Let me tell you, she's like, I mean, man, she can sing it, and you'll think that she's like, oh my gosh, hey, baby. But then she'll say, you know what? Can you take 23, go back to take 1, cut that word out, put that there. So she knew where those vocals were. Just, I mean, a beast about it. There are some vocalists who don't even want to be in the studio when you comp their vocals. Why? I don't understand it, but I would be there. Christina Aguilera, that situation happened. I mean, that was a weird one, but when Ron told me, he says, hey, man, listen, I got this girl. I want you to produce her. Da-da-da-da. Britney Spears was out. All I kept thinking was, oh, my God, another Britney Spears. You got to be kidding. Because she had no records out. I didn't know who she was. And I'm just like, okay, send her to me, all right? So I had her booked for 3 days. That's the way it works. I'm like, okay, well, we got to cut background vocals. We got to cut leads. And then if I have any follow-ups, I need another day, you know, to cut the vocals. And these aren't all-day sessions. You know, they're like roughly 6 hours. You know, that's usually the max because you can't even push a vocal, especially a lead vocal, more than 2 hours. So she came out to me, little girl weighing about 93 pounds, and I hadn't heard her sing before. And so I said, well, you know what? I said, you know the song? And she goes, yeah, I know it. I'm like, all right. I said, well, let's go into the vocal studio and let's see what you got. So as a producer, you are always in record. As an engineer, you are always in record. You never say stop until the singer stops. Never, ever, ever, never, ever, because they could give you that thing, you know what I mean? And you can't get it back. So I say, well, look, let's just go get a warm-up, run through the song for me, and let me hear where you're at. And back at this time, I was recording on something called ADATS, right? And that was like the first digital 8 tracks that were out, but I had like 4 of them, right? She goes in that vocal booth, right? And I'm like, all right, you know, okay, let's just take a take. And all I'm thinking is, they sending me this dang on, like, girl who can't sing, another Mickey Mouse Club girl. I'm like, ah, you know, because I still hadn't heard her sing, right? I put it in record because that's the mechanism, right? That's what you do. And I did a song called, this was a song called So Emotional on the Genie in the Bottle record. So it starts going, and I'm just sitting there at the board like, So she starts singing, right? My jaws are like, all right. And she sings the whole song because I'm not stopping until she stops, right? She is killing the whole, I mean, just killing, like I'm just sitting there going, oh my God, oh my God. So the song stops. I go over to my vocal booth, boom, kick the door open, I stand, I go. And she's like, what? I'm like, what do you mean, what? I was like, she's like, what? I'm like, what? Are you kidding me? I'm like, I didn't know you could sing like that. And she goes, I'm like, oh my God, right? And in my mind, I'm like, oh, man, this just got real, right? Okay, now all my producing chops, right? So here's the cool thing. I didn't have to do anything because all those years of bad singers of recording and playing and all of the cheap equipment, working my way up, working with those singers, it was all right there, right now. It was great. So then I go, well, wait a minute. So what we had to do, it's unfortunate because on that record, the very first verse is the first time I heard her sing. The very first verse. The second verse, I had smoking, but it was a little too R&B. So I had to, you know, the record company's like, well, she's not that kind of singer. I was like, are you kidding me? Right? And so we had to go clean that up. We cut the background vocals, everything in one day. So I had her for 2 more days. We would just go hang out at Wendy's because she loved Wendy's, right? And And she loved Sugar Ray. And she would talk about guys. And it was great. And I would give her, like, I gave her, she was tired when we had to do the bridge. So I gave her some coffee with hazelnut creamer in it, right? So imagine, she's 90 pounds, right? She was buzzing off the wall. She's like, oh my God. I was like, hey, slow down. And it was such a crazy experience that she even put that on her album in the notes. She goes, Ron, thank you for the crazy coffee episode, right? Which is really, really cool. But one of the things that I will tell you singers, while I was comping the vocal, and before she had to go do ad-libs, she was only listening to Mariah Carey and Brandy. So while I go, hold on a second, let me put this vocal together before you sing the bridge or whatever, she would put her Walkman on, and she would just be sitting working on her riffs. That's all she would do. So then I'd be like, okay, let's go. So she was in gear. You see what I'm saying? She was doing what it was taking. It was like her theme songs to get her vocal, you know, thing on. And that's how she would hit it and attack it. So, any other questions? Yes, sir.
Who were like your friends passed up on that you kind of regretted passing up on, like after?
Well, here's the thing about acts, and this is a great lesson for you guys. I mean, there are a lot. Yeah, my one partner who I do A&R for, he didn't pass on it, but he wanted it, and it was John Legend, right? And it's like when you do A&R, here's your rule of thumb. You can't get everyone. You can't do it. It's just not. But what you guys can learn from, you know how you may hear a song the first time before somebody else, all right, and you go, man, I know this song is going to be big, right? Use that as your compass, right? Use that to know that you know. Right? That you know. You got to use that because, believe it or not, we all have it. So it's a matter of if we learn to believe in it. So whether you win or lose, so say for instance, he wanted John Legend, I wanted Usher. I couldn't get Usher, right? So disappointment on one hand, but on the other hand, I knew I was on to something. So it's a win-win. It may seem like a lose, but it's actually a win. Because what happens is then you start to trust your instinct. And the more you do it, the more you trust your instinct. And go, nope, this is why I know is great. This is great. So you win one way or another. But you just really can't sign everything. You just can't do it. Yes, sir?
As an A&R or a manager, are there like boundaries of befriending or keeping a relationship like business with an artist?
Well, they should keep it business, right? I mean, you don't want to kind of mix that stuff up, man, because it gets kind of ugly quick, you know. It doesn't mean just like anything else, right? I mean, it does happen, you know. But, you know, you kind of, you know, if you're really about business, you want to take care of your business and try and keep that and work on the best behalf of the artist or, you know, whatever. But when that Cupid's arrow hit, I mean, who knows, right? So I'm just, you know. Any other questions we got? Anybody, anything? Yes, sir.
First of all, thank you so much for coming to Loyola. Second of all, that was a wonderful story about Christina. Oh. And that must have been an incredible moment.
Oh, yeah.
And I told you just before you hit the stage that I was just reading that John Seabrook book, the Song Factory, The Hit Machine. And I've been thinking a lot about hits, and I wonder if you have anything to say about your 20, 25 years in the business. If you see any changes in the role of hits in the business, how hits are made, do hits come from radio, do they come from identifying a great song, do they come from the audience?
Both
in the relative importance in the business, and also how hits are made.
Great. I really wish for those of you who want to be songwriters and producers, you could really see how people write like the most popular songs, right? Sometimes they come from tracks. Sometimes they come in a room with producers. There's a young writer that I've worked with. Her name is Julia Michaels, right? Julia Michaels started at 15. She was in a punk rock band. The family needed money. She got signed to a publishing deal. And I don't know, I'm sure your class is going over publishing deals and stuff like that. So that's where the writer just writes songs, right? She got in with a couple of different producers. She lucked up. I don't want to even say luck up because luck is not even it. She got a song that she wrote with Zedd and Selena Gomez. Selena Gomez says, you know what? I like the way you write. I like what you say from me. So she wrote, so this girl's 15, 16, 17, 18 now, right? 19. She wrote Sorry, Justin Bieber. Good for you, right? She's only 22 now. And she just signed a $1 million deal last year, right? Now, with that being said, going back to how hits are made, when those writers come in there, you have to learn how to think out loud, right? That's what, so like if you play a couple of guitar riffs, a writer who has written those hits would come in there and be like, oh yeah, keep it right there. And they're just hitting it, right? And they hit it with this conviction that's like, yeah, yeah. And it's all about humming a killer melody. So it's always about melody. Max Martin, you know, Dr. Luke, they have great guys who do that all day. All day. They just work on that melody. So the hits are a little different now than they used to be. But they still have hit factories, right? So Max Martin and that group out of Sweden, I mean, imagine you can sign the best writers, the best drum programmer, the best background arranger, and that's why Max Martin can bring you everything like Hit Me Baby One More Time to The Weeknd's I Can't Feel My Face. Same guy, right? Same guy. Since you've been gone, same guy, Dr. Luke came from that. So they do have hit factories, and they do now what they call writer's camps. So it would be like Rihanna's looking for songs. Everyone's going to go to a writing camp for the week. They're going to rent out all of these studios, and the best song wins. And they walk from studio to studio. All right, cool. Oh, man, that's hot. I want that one right there. So right now, because it's so hard to get a cut, you got more people throwing it at it. But great songs are still crafted the same way. The ones that are truly, truly, truly great. The Hello, Adele, Greg Kurstin, and Adele, boom, just still crafted the old-fashioned way. In pop music and mainstream music, there's no particular right or wrong to having a hit, but the ones that last are still crafted. You're basic. Hey, I came up with a great idea, a great story. You know. And I know you had a question. Yeah.
Actually,
it does. Oh, that's actually going up before he raises his hand. You know. Any other questions? Yeah.
Well, he was just full of those questions. Yes.
Did you work with DJ Premier on that Christina record?
No.
No?
Usually producers work within their own little thing. So you all end up at the same record release party, but you are doing your own thing separately, you know. So I had my own thing, and, you know, so did Robin Thicke and Sturken and Rogers and Diane Warren. So... Yes, sir.
Can you please talk a little about the politics that's going into major labels?
Mm-hmm. It's a
ton of them. If you think the politics in the normal world of politics or something, politics at record labels, man, whoo, because it's like, now you're talking about all ego, right? And say, for instance, you have a hot act, right? And I go, man, you got a great act, and I'm the head of the record label. I'm the great act, da da da, and da da da. But Ethan here is my senior VP. He's my lieutenant. All it takes is Ethan to lean in my ear one day. Hey, man, I don't think that act is that great. They got, you know, they've had some problems. I go, really? He goes, yeah, yeah. And then the next day, you're like, hey, man, what about that money for that video? And I go, I don't know, man. You know, and it can happen just like that. just like that. I mean, done. And a record label, the rule of thumb is we can spend as much money as we want. Even if you spend $5 million on an act, if you don't think that that act has the thing, you drop it. It's the way it is. You drop it. You let it go. And artists go, man, they spent all that money and they let that act go. Because if you're not feeling it, you just drop it. So, you know, politic-wise, you just can't predict them. It all depends on who brings you in, you know, doing A&R. If somebody brings you in doing A&R, then they get fired, and then there's a new head. Guess what? It's only a matter of time. Yeah. Any other? Yes, sir. I'm sorry.
Okay. Yes, sir.
At what point did you, I guess, look in the mirror and say, I've made the right choice?
Well, you know what? Huh. And the reason why I pause is because there were a few of those that led me up to the final thing, right? So let me just fast forward up to doing the Christina Aguilera record. By the time I got there, I was just a little burnt, right? Because I've had, I also did a record, for those of you who know, there was a girl called Adina Howard. It's like, I'll be a freak in the morning, freak in the evening, right? Whatever. And so, I was just like, man, I just don't know, right? Because you're constantly questioning yourself. So after we had done the Christina record, I was just like really dejected, right? I was just like, here's another thing. I mean, even though she's dope, right? I'm just like, I don't know. I hadn't done records before, so I don't know what it's going to turn into, right? So when they released Genie in the Bottle, and I started seeing it everywhere, and I'm on that record, right? And I'm like, okay, my goal was to, I wanted to get my first gold record, right? I was like, that's all I was dreaming about. If I could get a plaque on my wall, then I'll know that I've made that right choice, right? Because that was my dream. That was my measuring stick. When I called my attorney, after the record had been out for 3 weeks, the way it works is that they ordered a record from the record, you know, all the record stores, because you still had record stores then. So they would order the record from the record stores. So I called my attorney, and I'll never forget, I said, hey, Alan, I said, so, you know, how's it going? He goes, dude, he goes, are you ready for this? Because all I care about is when can I get my plaque for my gold records, right? And the gold record is 500,000. Platinum record is 1 million copies, just so you know. So I'm like, man, she's got to be at 500. I hear the song everywhere. So he says, are you sitting down? I go, yeah. He goes, she's shipping 1.5 million. I'm like, what? I'm like, 1.5. So now my brain goes, I'm getting a platinum record, right? So that's the way it works. So you got the gold and platinum. So by the time I ordered my plaque, she had sold 10 million copies. And that, my friend, is when I looked in the mirror and said, yeah, I made the right choice. Thank you, guys.